Thanks for having me. So we live in an interconnected world, an increasingly interconnected world. Apologies, what you're looking at right here is a visualization of air traffic over North America that I created a couple years ago. This isn't a system that's architected. It doesn't have a master plan, but it's actually the result of hundreds of decisions being made by people all across North America, pilots, air traffic controllers, kind of all working together to create the system. Communication technologies has enabled an unprecedented form of collaboration. I create data visualization art like this, and today I'm going to talk about a specific subset of the art projects I've been working on that deal with methods of collaboration, people working together to create something larger than the sum of its parts. My journey into collaboration begins with this guy. This is Baron Wolfgang von Kempelen's mechanical chess-playing machine. And basically, this is a robot that plays chess extremely well, except, of course, that it's not a robot at all. But as a matter of fact, there's a man that sits in the bottom and controls this thing, pretending to be a computer. This is the inspiration for a web service by Amazon called the Mechanical Turk. If you could read up there, it says artificial intelligence is what they call it. The premise of it is you can employ people through the internet to do small tasks in a completely distributed manner. So being about 50% artist, 50% nerd, I was both completely intrigued and blown away by the potential power of a system like this, but also saw dystopic futures and kind of thinking about the ramifications for what this means for work coming forward. I decided to create a project to visualize the system and begin experimenting with it. So I created a little drawing tool and I said, draw a sheep facing to the left and I'll pay you 2 cents for your toils. These are a few of the first drawings that came back. A lot of sheep. Tons of sheep. And I took the first 10,000 sheep and I put them on a website called thesheepmarket.com. And you can actually roll over each individual one, and juxtaposed against that huge grid is the individual process that each person went through when they drew it. And you can actually see the humanity of each individual juxtaposed against this massive system. On the website, I put all the sheep up for sale in bundles of 20. And although I had only paid people 20 cents, I sold them in blocks as a commodity for $20, this grossly inflated price. Kind of to begin a dialogue about what it means to be working online with intellectual property and also with this idea of this distributed system where nobody has any context. They have no idea why they're drawing the sheep. They're just participating in something larger. Here's a few statistics from the project. There were 11 sheep per hour that came in, which makes an average wage of 69 cents per hour. That means there's 662 rejected sheep that didn't meet sheep-like criteria and were thrown out of the mix. The longest time spent drawing was 46 minutes, and the shortest time was 4 seconds. So that gives you an idea of the different motivations that were going into it. And there were 7,599 unique IP addresses, so that's about how many individual people participated in the project. But from all those people, only one of them asked this. Why? Which I expected a little bit more. It's kind of a bizarre request. There's a few reasons that I chose to ask people to draw sheep. One is they're the first animal to be raised for mechanically processed byproducts. They're also the first to be selectively bred for their production traits. First animal to be cloned. First, they're well known as being recognized similar for being a follower. And there's this reference to the book Le Petit Prince where the prince asks the narrator to draw a sheep and he draws sheep after sheep. And only when he finally draws a box and says, use your imagination, it's not about the scientific representation, but about being more creative and individual. This is a frame from Charlie Chaplin's film Modern Times. This is kind of a film about the last major changes during the Industrial Revolution, when people were no longer shoemakers and tailors, but people in an assembly line slapping soles on boots. This particular sequence, Charlie Chaplin's being pushed through the gears, talking about this changing relationship. So I took frames from the film and divided it into 16 pieces. And I fed those pieces into the Mechanical Turk and paid people 5 cents for each piece. So nobody has any idea what it is that they're working on, but they're building this rotoscoped video. This inspired a project that I worked on with my friend Takashi Kawashima, where we used the Mechanical Turk for exactly what it's meant for, which is making money. I took a $100 bill and divided it into 10,000 pieces and then paid people the value of that portion. So for one penny, people were making these teeny little drawings with no idea of what it was they were doing and creating this massive distributed forgery. These forged bills were put online on this website, 10,000cents.com, where you're actually able to exchange real $100 bills for these forged $100 bills, and then the donation of that goes to a $100 laptop project to get laptops to kids to potentially create more bills. But as opposed to the sheep market where there were rejected sheep, here, everything that anyone drew was included in the bill. So you get a representation of all the different types of participation, including the person that wrote 1 cent, really? and smiley faces and various other things. This is a time lapse that you can see on the website of all 10,000 people creating this $100 bill, and you can see each individual piece drawing in. This is another project that I worked on with my friend Daniel Massey. It's called Bicycle Built for 2000. And this is a shot of Max Matthews at Bell Labs in the 60s, where he created the world's first singing computer. Some of you may be familiar with the song from 2001 Space Odyssey. At the end of the film, when Hal's dying, he sings this song. It's kind of a nod to the moment where computers became human. I was really interested in this idea of Mechanical Turk, where people are pretending to be machines, and here where machines are pretending to be people, and kind of what this all might mean. So we took the song, divided, resynthesized it into individual notes. I think you may be able to hear the synthesis of the original song right now.
A-Z, give me your answer.
So we took that song and all the individual notes, and we fed it into a program on the Mechanical Turk, where people would enter the request code from their task, test the microphone,
Hello.
Receive a small sound clip, just one individual note, and then they'd recreate it to the best of their abilities. And we collected these sound clips from all around the world and reassembled them to begin making the song. So this is what the first batch of clips sounds like when put together. So basically, we took all those different variations and we stacked them on top of one another and assembled a distributed chorus. So everybody was singing individual notes and sounds. And then we put that together on this website, Bicycle Built for 2000, where you can listen to each individual contribution or you can actually hear the chorus. I'm just going to play a clip from it. So I'll talk just very briefly about this project. It's a music video that I worked on with music video director James Frost for the band Radiohead. And I think my favorite part of this project was that we released it as an open source project on Google Code, which basically meant I wrote a bit of computer software that allows you to create your own renderings from the data that we open sourced and released to everyone. And what this meant was that there was a YouTube channel and various other forums where people were creating their own versions of the video and sharing them with other people. These are two of my favorites. This is the Pinboard Tom York and the Lego Tom York animation. Even more recently, somebody even 3D printed Tom York's head from the data that we released. And to me, I was really inspired about this, this idea of people working together, but not because there was a financial motivation, and actually with a lot of context, understanding what it was that they were working on and working together to build something. So we thought we could take this a little bit further. I teamed up with my friend Chris Milk to build a project for Rick Rubin's final album for Johnny Cash, which is, there's a track called Ain't No Grave, which is largely about kind of Johnny Cash's resurrection. It's this final track. And we thought, what better way to make a music video for this project than to get people to contribute and build up a music video as kind of his resurrection. So these are a few frames from the project, different drawings by different people, kind of all working off the same base together to build out the video. So what you see here is if you go to the johnnycashproject.com, you can watch the video as it grows and changes because it's always being developed. You can also contribute to the project. What you'll see on the website is the video on the upper portion of the screen, and then these stalactites begin to form as people submit new drawings. So I just wanted to close out with one quick video that kind of summarizes this project because it's better seen than talked about.
What better way to pay tribute to the man than to make something for one of his songs?
I felt really sad when he died, and I just thought it would be wonderful, it would be really nice to contribute something to his memory.
It really allows this last recording of his to be a living, breathing memorial.
For all of the frames to be drawn by fans, each individual frame, it's got a very powerful feeling to it.
I've seen everybody from Japan, Venezuela, to the States, you know, to Knoxville, Tennessee.
As much as it's different from frame to frame, it really is
personal.
Watching back the video of my frame, I could see me not understanding at the beginning of it, and I just worked and worked through problems until my little wee battles that I was fighting within the picture all began to resolve themselves. You can actually see the point where I know what I'm doing, when a light and a dark comes into it. And in a weird way, that's what I actually like about Johnny Cash's music as well. It's the sum total of his life, all the things that have happened. You know, the bad things, the good things, you're hearing a person's life.
Thanks very much.